Hey folks, this is Best in Slot. Welcome back to Prehistoric Kingdom. Every Friday evening at 7 p.m. we live stream PK right here on the channel, and we've been working on this post-apocalyptic, horror-themed, quarantined, abandoned Jurassic World, Jurassic Park-inspired build. Now, it is becoming less Jurassic-inspired, as you'll see in this build today, which basically has nothing to do with Jurassic at all, but there's always going to be a little bit of that inspiration in there as well. So I've been streaming this for the last 3 weeks for part two of this video, part two of this series, and that is what we're going to work on today. We're going to build ourselves our Dilophosaurus habitat. Now, it's part one of the Dilophosaurus habitat, but the Dilophosaurus is here, and it is 3 streams worth, so I kind of, if I don't upload it now, the video will go on for about 5,000 hours. But we are going to add a dilo by the end of today's video. So in the last video, we built the entrance, the courtyard sort of area, and that's been blocked off by these big military doors, these big military walls that have been erected to keep this spreading infection contained. The park has been abandoned, the facility's been abandoned, and now they've blocked the whole thing off. There's a quarantine station set up, and there's military vehicles as well. Today, instead, we're going beyond the wall and entering the facility. The plan changed quite a bit. You're going to see a fairly sharp jump at some point in time. Originally, this was meant to be a park. It was going to be a dinosaur park, like Jurassic World. And then there would be a seedy underbelly kind of thing. I love a seedy underbelly. There was going to be a seedy underbelly. And that was going to be facility stuff and experiments and gene manipulation and all that kind of more science-y gone wrong kind of aspect. But it changed in this episode. Really, we're kind of just making this up as we go along, as per usual. And it's going to be more facility-based. It's not really a park per se. Maybe we can do touring sections where, you know, the owners of the facility would come and give prospective backers or prospective donors like a tour and say, oh, you support us or invest in us or something like that. But it's not meant to be a open-to-the-public park tour kind of thing. It's a little bit inspired by Resident Evil, you'll see when we get there, but all we're doing at the moment is just building the other side of the wall. And can't have the path starting instantly because, of course, the path wouldn't have been there. The wall has been put up at the edge of the park, at the edge of the facility. So it's just a little bit of a walk through the countryside first, which is helpful because it means I can talk for a little bit. So yeah, I'm just moving all the foliage across, building in the exact same style. I was going to make it more tropical in here, but I wasn't finding the tropical trees were really lending themselves to the area that well. It just wasn't fitting. They're less bushy. Any bush. Any good bush. So I just decided to stick with the redwoods and the exact same plants we're already using. And it keeps the whole thing thematically tied together. And also kind of sells that idea that it's nature encroaching on the area and kind of tightening the noose around the whole area. And that kind of fits better with what we're trying to do here anyway. Which is, in a way, nature fighting back. As I say, you are going to see a jump. So I did start with the idea of building a park, and I built this really weird... People who are on the stream will have seen it. It was terrible. It's just this circle building with a big old hole in the middle, and it was rubbish, and it didn't work. And I spent about an hour on it, and it took a lot of work mentally, but I deleted the whole thing and just thought, you know, so much in these videos I will say to you, just stick with it. It might look terrible now, but just stick with it. Force your way through it. And, you know, if you've got a good, solid idea, keep going through the awkward phases and eventually you'll end up somewhere good. But the inverse of that is also knowing when an idea is just bad. We talk about this all the time in football. A manager, you know, sometimes you've got to give a manager a little bit of time. Look at how Arteta is doing with Arsenal this season. But, you know, not necessarily. Sometimes there are just bad managers. And you've got to know when it's an idea worth scrapping and when it's one you should push through. And really, the defining factor for me is more just if I've got a really solid idea in mind, and at this point I didn't. I was kind of trying to collate it right now as I'm building this little nature section. There should be a lot less of this going forward. There's a little bit more in a minute, but going forward in the build, we're not going to do something you would tour around. My idea for this is, as it always is, kind of inspired by the likes of Disney and Universal Studios, Halloween nights and stuff like that, where you'd go on a guided walking tour through an area and they would try to scare you. You wouldn't wander off on your own, you wouldn't take alternate paths. You're following a very thematic, very strongly themed set path, and then things try to kill you along the way. That's kind of what we're going for. So you're going to enter the facility, you're going to enter it in this video, and you're going to follow along the route that I set, and various things will happen, various exhibits will pop up. We will go back outside, but it's kind of more like a horror video game. You know what I'm like. Anyone who's watched me for a long time will not find this surprising. But the build became very inspired by horror video games in this episode. So you're going to have a set route to take, and maybe you'll have to figure out where to go. And if I could do like little things like have you go off to find a key card and stuff like that, that would be amazing. I guess we could kind of do that. It would be up to the player to not lie, I suppose. But we could have like a locked door. Right, no, how could I ever do that? I could just say you're not allowed down this corridor until you find the key card, basically. And then trust that the players are going to do the right thing. But that seems optimistic. Anywho, feel free to join us on Fridays, by the way. Friday, 7 p.m. UK time is when I stream. Near enough every Friday. And it's good fun. It's fairly chill. There's not that many people, so it's, you know, fairly low-key, and everyone gets to join in and, you know, be part of a community feeling, all that kind of jazz. And, you know, you get to be part of the builds, basically. Some of the ideas, a lot of the ideas, are inspired by things people have said in the chat. So this was, I think, where the cut is about to be, because I think, yeah, there it is. So I was trying to build, I went and built a building, and there's no point in me including it, because it'd be about 10 minutes of me talking about something that's not in the build. So I changed my mind and decided, well, it still needs to look like it maybe would have been a wider facility. We're kind of trying to sell the idea that this is a bigger park or a bigger facility than it actually is. So you're going to emerge from the wilderness onto a road, inspired a little bit by the visitor center in Jurassic Park. You know, the road cuts across and you've got a stairway up into this building. It's not going to look like the visitor center, but that kind of style, you know, with this sort of the stone staircase and all this kind of jazz, is sort of visitor center inspired. And of course, this road here is where the cars would have parked up. That's about where the similarities are going to end, though, it must be said. This is still all part of the first stream, and I must admit, so this is three streams, as I say. This is act one of three that you're seeing here. This is the one where I was really struggling to solidify the idea. Act two and act three went really well. Act three in particular had a good time, but act one was a struggle. Those of you who were there will know I was getting very frustrated in this part of the build. So yeah. Just had to pause to die from a coughing fit there. So kind of like how the mansion in Resident Evil is outwardly not a particularly spooky building. You know, it's a fairly regular old mansion in the middle of a dark forest filled with zombie dogs, like all mansions. Okay, it's not that outwardly not spooky, but the idea is the outside of this building is going to be fairly classical, and then we can kind of do whatever we want inside. There's going to be normal bits, there's going to be exhibits. It's hopefully going to flow like you are walking around and seeing all these dinosaurs and stuff like that. Some of them are broken out. Some of them are where they shouldn't be, like the Dilophosaurus in today's video. Some of them are in exhibits. You'll kind of see what I mean when we get there. But the idea is that because this is kind of the tip, I guess, of the facility, you know, this is near the exit, this is still quite quarantine heavy. This is still very much got that science aspect where they were trying to, you know, scan people for the fungal infection and all this kind of jazz. So that's kind of the focus today. And there'll be less of that the deeper we go, because we're getting closer to ground zero, where people were just trying to get out alive, you know, and some of the dinosaurs are still sort of trapped in their original exhibit, stuff like that. It's mainly vibes, I'm not going to lie, but we are building a story as we go. But anyways, this was, yeah, this is a big-ass building. And I knew I wasn't going to build the entire building. You're not going to see the rest of the building, so this is just a shell. You know, this is just something that sits at the front, so it looks like you're entering the building. You're never going to see it from the outside again, so it doesn't really matter. I want you to feel like you enter this building and you're entering another world. You're entering this maze of corridors and this maze of different areas. And it's kind of like you're stepping over the precipice, you know what I mean? Like in classic storytelling and stuff like that, there's always that moment where you enter that new world and what you think you know changes forever. And that's entering this building is kind of like you've kind of broken into this facility. It's kind of like the start of Outlast, and we are going to be inspired by Outlast very briefly later on. But they come up to the house, and we've kind of had that area, you know, you've seen a few dinosaurs, and that's a bit of a thing, but you've kind of had the walk up to the house and the drive through to the house, you've got through the initial gate, and then entering the building is when things truly kick off and the horror begins, essentially. The rest of the building at this point will be designed to work at nighttime. Today's build is 100% designed to work at nighttime. I mean, it just would not function in daytime. No matter, there's just nothing I can do about that. It is 100% designed for nighttime, and you will see why. But I will try to make most of it work in day and night. You know, it's always better if it can function in both. But when I tell you this build, this part of the build wouldn't have worked in any other time of day. You'll see what I mean. But again, really had no solid ideas here. I'm just trying to make the building look less stupid. That's really all there is to this part of the video. It's the building looks silly. It's very boring. It's very flat. And I was just trying to make the entrance stand out a little bit, look a little bit more interesting. I was hitting a creative wall, and I just wanted the stream to end at this point because I had this really obnoxious building that I didn't know what to do with. I actually still need to do a little bit of work on it, but it's getting there. It's getting there. Edging it a little bit, which is, you know, always fun. Top tip for any building, really, just stick a little bit of stone at the bottom, a little bit of brick, a little bit of wood, a little bit of whatever is necessary, you know, just a little bit of material where the building connects with the floor, makes your building already feel monumentally more realistic. It still just looks like a slab though, doesn't it? I promise it'll get better, but you can tell by the length of time this bit is taking me that I wasn't really sure of what I was doing, and sometimes you just need to stop. Now, this was one of the revelations, which was just changing the texture, and we ended up settling on... I liked that kind of, like, metal, because it gives it this kind of... It's meant to be a scientific facility in the day. It's not open to the public. It's going to receive guests, as I say. You know, they want to try to bring a little income in, so you kind of have people talk. Kind of like how, you know, Claire, at the very start of Jurassic World, was taking people around the sort of the more interior scientific part of Jurassic World, showcasing things, because they want to, you know, get investors... excited. This is the same idea. You need to give the impression, at least, of this big scientific facility on the outside. So we're combining the stone and the metal, which I think gives it that right kind of look to look sciencey, but also like they've maybe modified an older building or something like that. And just building a little bit of a roof here. In retrospect, it's too thin, I think. I've thickened it up here, but maybe I need to do a little bit more. I'm going to do a little bit more with it. I've got some ideas with what I want to do with the roof going forward, but we shall see. But it's looking better. It's looking better. But soon there will be a revolutionary change. I think that... Is that the end of Act 1? I'm just staring at it at this point. Just thinking, what the heck do I do with this thing? And then I can't remember how I got the idea, but I had a little bit of a brainwave, and this was the brainwave. Okay, so... I was thinking of, it doesn't really make sense, I'm not going to pretend otherwise, but I was thinking of, you know when they fumigate a building and you kind of cover it in fabric, well it's not fabric, it's like plasticky sort of fabric, you drape it over the whole thing to stop the toxic fumes escaping and it kind of contains everything inside and you kill everything with the fumes, right? It was inspired by that. I'm not going to say it totally makes sense and we'll make them look a little bit better later on, but that set me off on... an adventure. That set me off on a theory of how this building was going to look. And trying to sell it more so sort of the... You know, at the end of the day, this was a nice building, but now it's been abandoned. It's been left alone. It's been left to die. So I thought, well, okay, let's... You know, it's been condemned, right, by the government, so you're not allowed to be in here anymore. We're going to be, because we're a badass. But I figured, okay, so you've got these things draping down. You want to block off the building a little bit, but you also need maybe a biohazard symbol. I was really proud of this. This took a lot of, as you're about to watch, a lot of finagling around with many circles. But I made this little biohazard symbol, which we'll be applying to a few different... Actually, it wasn't that difficult. But we'll be applying that to a few different things across the build going forward, because it just... I was really proud of it, honestly. Like, except that black circle. There we go. I was really proud of it. I think it looked really good. And, yeah, just finishing that off. Just looks like a proper official little biohazard symbol, hopefully. And we can apply that to a few different things. And just gives it a little bit of feeling of realism. Stuff like that, I suppose. And just, you know, we're saying that what's happened to this building is that this... biohazardous fungus has maybe, you know, we were experimenting on it and it's escaped, it's leaking out all over the place, havoc ensues, dinosaurs break out, yada yada. Maybe it gets into the system and the electricity goes down. I don't really know, but either way, maybe there were zombies. Maybe there were zombies. Okay, but the point is, it works. So sticking the biohazard symbol on there, and then we're going to duplicate this across a few times. And annoyingly, it's fabric and then a flat circle, so it's never, you know, flush in the way I would have liked, but I think it's pretty effective at selling the feeling I wanted. So at this point, I still didn't like the building, but I was becoming happier with the idea. You know, we can look at, make it look condemned, we can kind of block off some of the stuff, we're going to add some windows in the next part, but at the very least, it was moving in the right direction. And I very nearly deleted this building as well. This is the one which I'm glad I stuck with, whereas I'm very happy I deleted the first one, because that first building would have taken us in a entirely different direction in terms of the build. I don't know where I would have gone after that, but everything would have changed when the Fire Nation attacked. And I think that is basically, that's just me just looking at it, trying to see if I'm okay with it. I think that's basically the end of Act 1. Yes, so Act 2 is working on the outside of the building a little bit more, moving the things hanging down to a more reasonable area, finishing off these. I don't know what these are, but you do see these on the outside of buildings. It's like a temporary fencing, temporary scaffolding kind of thing. I technically don't know what they do, but I do see them all the time in like post-apocalyptic scenarios. So that's good enough for me. You know, again, we're just trying to sell a rough story here. We're trying to sell a vibe, a story, a feeling. And that's spookiness. So if it sells the vibe, it sells the feeling, then we can put it in. I do want things to make some form of logical sense, and there are considerations for that. We're going to build some pretty wild things in this PK build today. We're going to come up with some pretty novel ideas, I think, on how to build things that aren't currently in the game, so I hope you'll enjoy that when we get there. But I don't know why I decided to do this. I stuck a fence on the top of all of it. I don't know. Sometimes when I don't know what I'm doing, like I don't have the wider idea quite yet, which I didn't at this point, I just start doing stupid things. You know, just little details. It's kind of like how, not that I'm a genius, but you know when they say that if you are, right, and let's say you're working on a particularly difficult problem, one of the good things you can do is work on something very mundane, because your brain kind of ticks away in the background. You're not really thinking of the problem, but you just let your brain tick away doing its thing, and eventually, because you're just kind of focused on this mundanity, your brain kind of realizes what it was looking for. You know what I mean? It's a well-known phenomenon. Just building a little thing here for the fabric to hang down from. You can see I've extended that a little bit. I'm going to move this onto all the sides as well, because it kind of just, it looked ridiculous before. It looked like a pretty little curtain thing. That's not really the idea. So sticking some windows on the side of the buildings and largely hiding them in the fabric. Just trying to make the building look like it was a nice fancy science building, and now it's condemned. But the left and the right hand sides, and this is really the main focus of Act 2. Really sounds pretentious when I call it Act 2, but the main focus of Act 2 is the left and right hand sides of the building. You can't just have this big wide open area. I want to sell the impression that there's a whole of a park beyond that, right? There's a whole stretch of park that you just don't have access to. Maybe you will later on. You know, this is a video game, so we're kind of trying to sell the idea of distance and potential that this isn't Dragon's Dogma 2. You can't go wherever you like, but it's a Call of Duty campaign instead. So I'm trying to sell you the idea of things that might happen down the line. and this was a little bit inspired by Jurassic Park as well. Of course, you know, I thought I wanted to do a Dilophosaurus habitat, so Dennis Nedry inspired. When Dennis Nedry runs into the Dilophosaurus, of course, there is a tunnel to the down the side of the road. You get a very brief glimpse of it. It's on the right-hand side. As you're going down the hill towards the Dilophosaurus with the car behind you, the left leads off into forest and the rest of the park, and the right takes you into a tunnel through the mountains like this. Also similar to the tunnel, which again, you very, very briefly see in only in the widescreen version, I believe. You see it when they first enter the Tyrannosaurus Rex paddock. They come through a tunnel in the mountain, just like this. But again, it's something you don't really see in the film, which is a shame. I like tunnels. So I'm trying to sell the idea that there's a tunnel here going through the earth, leading to God knows where. But I just want to give that slight Jurassic Park feeling, you know, this tunnel over here. And we're going to make it a little bit overgrown and stuff like that. And I did my little cheat where that's what I was building initially, where you put like a blank dark wall at the very far end of the tunnel, and it kind of suggests distance, I guess, in that way. We're going to be changing the colour of the path to make that a little bit more realistic as well. And did some very quick foliage work. I will say my foliage speed has increased dramatically in this game. I've got a lot better at it in the last... I mean, this is the most I've really spent on a build. This is already 20 hours or something, 22 hours or something like that on this Prehistoric Kingdom Park so far. Okay, that's probably not the most, but for two exhibits, for me, that's quite a long time. I don't usually spend this long on every single exhibit I build, but we're doing a lot of work in every single one of them. And we don't tend to get the dinosaurs in until the third act, as it were. But yeah, just building a little tunnel, a little bit of light down there so you can... I'm just trying to sell the idea. You can kind of see it. It looks good there. It looks good at night. It doesn't quite work as well in daytime. But it looks like a tunnel that goes on for much longer than we can see. And that's all I'm trying to sell with that, really. You're not allowed down there. You're never allowed down there because you'd see behind the building and you'd see that the building is a facade. It's kind of like, again, it's like a movie set, basically. You imagine it like a haunted house tour kind of thing where as long as you're looking at things from the right side, they look full and terrifying and real. And if you look behind it, you see the person in the mask or you see the bit of string holding everything up, you know. This is my ode to Hollywood. Somehow. Horror games and horror films, which is all I care about in my life, really. Also means that if I do this and I block things off, it means I don't have to worry about what the rest of the park looks like. And I say this all in like, oh, I'm trying to build a horror game, blah, blah, blah. But the reason to build like this and to keep your guest very controlled in this way, in part, is because you don't have to worry about what it looks like over there and what it looks like over there and how they get from here to there. You know, people are following a very defined path and I control what every sight line looks like. And that makes me happy because I like my sight lines to look really good. I like to have lots of dramatic imagery, but people can look wherever they want to look. You kind of lose that. And at this point, I deleted these vines by accident. I'm not sure when this happens, but I'm 99% sure I kill all the vines at some point. There they go. And it was really annoying to do, so I haven't rebuilt them quite yet. But start hanging some ivy and stuff like that, some overgrowth on there, just so it looks like it's been there for a long time. You know, the facility has been abandoned for an indeterminate amount of time. It's a little bit iffy. You know, maybe one of the reasons the moss in this area is so powerful and so potentially traumatic and dangerous is because this area experiences like supernatural growth. You know, everything here grows very, very quickly and very powerfully, and that's why the nature has so quickly come and overtaken the landscape and, you know, sort of reclaims the area, as it were. I like the idea of nature in my parks feeling sentient as a collective, almost, in that they it fights back, you know, and it means to fight back. Reminds me of The Ruins. It's an okay little film. I want to block off this side as well, so I've got a couple of vehicles over here. I thought I'd hint a little bit about the malevolence of the moss. It's kind of accrued here and, you know, maybe it took over the, you know, it knocked down the cars itself and it's eaten the people inside or something. I'm not quite sure what the moss does at this point in time, but I'm just aware that the moss is evil and must be destroyed. Maybe you get to destroy it at the end. I've been looking for an excuse to... there's a fire FX in this game. I've been looking for an excuse to use it. So maybe I could have the player, like, bomb the facility at the very end. And then, because what you could do is you could just duplicate this really easily. Like, duplicate this whole area. And have you come back outside at night through, like, a hidden area that you can't see here. And, like, the facility's burning. That could be, like, a really cool fight. Oh, I like that idea. I have to write that down. I think it'd be quite easy to make an exact duplicate of this. And say you come out of like a little tunnel in the foliage that you just can't see. We could even put it in here and just make you not able to see it because of the foliage, basically. And then you emerge out of it in front of the building. You've escaped from the facility at the end after going through everything and the whole facility's burning down because you've activated the bomb or something like that, you know. Oh, I like that a lot. Right, anyways. So, this is now the main focus of the build for the rest of this video. This was inspired by, I guess, real-life quarantine. Also by Outlast, a little bit, as I say. And it's kind of like... So, the idea is that this was a normal facility, a scientific facility. And then the, what are they called? The CDC? The CHC? What are they called? The Center for Hugo Control? Yeah, the CHC. The CHC have come in, and they're attempting to you know, they're getting everyone out, they're getting rid of the sick people, they're trying to contain the dinosaurs, they're trying to do everything. And they've turned the building into, like, or the outskirts of the building, at least, into, like, a quarantine checkpost kind of thing. So it's meant to be, like, this sterile, quarantined corridor that you walk down. So I wanted white, plasticky sort of fabric on the sides, basically. And that's very much what we're going to be doing here. And this is how you're going to see the Dilophosaurus. You're going to walk down these tunnels, and this is really the bit that works at nighttime and not really daytime, because it looks really cool at nighttime. Just trust me, you'll see it pretty soon, hopefully. But the idea is, yeah, you'll walk into there and then you'll walk down these quarantine tunnels, and I think this is nearly the end of Act 2. Just a little bit more work on this bit, but you're never allowed to see outside of the tunnel because it just looks disastrous. Absolutely disastrous. And I'm just staring at it. Sometimes I'll just stare. You just have to think. Or I'm reading chat, actually. That's a good point. And you never know for sure. Oh, somebody was suggesting. So again, this is proof I do listen to people. You know, if you want to leave suggestions and stuff, I definitely pay attention to the live stream chat. Someone suggested I put the fabric on the ground, which I wasn't sure of, but I started to do it, and it really sold the vibe really nicely. It really does feel like you're walking down this fairly oppressive quarantined corridor. Kind of the corners were a pain in the ass, though. But it makes you feel like you're walking down this sort of oppressive, quarantined corridor kind of thing. Not like a safe, even though it's clean and tidy, it doesn't feel safe. And that's, you know, very much the goal. Of course, we're building a dinosaur park. Why would it not be like a terrifying horror game? Stop expecting anything else, you numpties. I'm only halfway through this video, man. I don't know how I talk like this. Most people don't do this. I'm aware of that. Most people do these videos and then they'll shut up. They'll do music, but it just feels wrong. I just want to talk nonsense. Sticking some walls on the sides because you could just glimpse every now and again like a little bit of light through gaps in the fabric, and rather than moving the fabric around, just stick some black walls on the outside and it just sort of blocks out the light. You can't notice it anyway. You never see that it's a black brick wall. It just looks like it's dark outside, or it looks like the fabric is covering it in totality, so works really well. Again, it's little things like that that I really like doing, little cheats, you know, just finding ways to make things in the game work for you. You're going to see quite a lot of that, especially in Act 3, as I say. Just using Prehistoric Kingdom items in sort of novel ways to make things that we don't have, and to cheat a little bit and to sell the impression of something that maybe isn't actually there. It's the general idea. General idea. I was just working on the tunnels. So the idea was, I wanted you to walk through. You're going to see the Dilophosaurus in a minute. Now, you're not going to see the Dilophosaurus. You're not going to be with the Dilophosaurus. I wanted you to have this very specific vibe in my head. And it was like, so I think this is Act, is this Act 3? I think this is Act 3. There's a T-junction here, okay? Now, you're going to go in here and you're going to go left. That's the correct way. But in front of you, there's going to be a red door blocked. And that's going to give you a view off where the Dilophosaurus is. And I just had this very strong image off my head of seeing, like, looking into this darkened room that's locked. You can't get into it. It's been blocked off by the quarantine. You know, it's been shut down for emergencies. And it's dark. Unfortunately, the game isn't that dark, so it doesn't sell it entirely. But it's dark with just red light in there. And every now and again, you see the Dilophosaurus pass by, you know? And that's very... Oh, this is still Act 2, I think, when I did this. Yeah, it is. And every now and again, you see... Or maybe you're just looking in there, you know, seeing if there's a way to get in, looking at what's in your future in this video game. And then the Dilophosaurus walks in, you know, and you're not going to contend with it. You don't have access to the Dilophosaurus. You know, it's in this room. This is Act 3 right here. We're building the... This is the Dilophosaurus exhibit, basically, this room right here. So you can't... You know, you're not in danger. It's behind a locked door, but it walks out. You know, it's not always there. It's going somewhere else, right? So the idea is very much, you know, whilst I'm safe right now, I know it's out there in the facility somewhere. I know there's a Dilophosaurus stalking around the area that I'm about to explore. I know that I'm in danger at some point. It's kind of like, I'm going to reference Dark Souls a lot when it comes to this, but Dark Souls is always my video game design inspiration because I just think it is as perfectly designed as a video game possibly gets. In the Undead Burg in Dark Souls, at one point, a dragon flies over your head. And doesn't feature again for quite a while. You'll actually go and you kill a boss, do various different things, and then at some point you're walking down a bridge and the dragon will fly by and burn you alive, right? Now there are hints that it's there again, but the point is you kind of, it's Chekhov's gun. Oh right, so this was me trying, I wanted to look at that little bit there on the door This is a very old video of me, okay? Very old. I was just looking. I had Outlast in my mind. I remembered I'd played Whistleblower on stream ages ago, so this was a little bit of the inspiration. Not really a direct copy at all. It's more the locked sign on the door is what I wanted. But this is the door that's going to keep you away from the Dilophosaurus. This is the door that's blocking the Dilophosaurus and you. But anyways, Chekhov's Dilophosaurus, basically. You know, it's not a problem yet, but it's going to eat you later, is the implication. I've spent a lot of time here. There's something this game is lacking, which I didn't realize. You can't color or darken. There were two main problems I had with this build. Number one is you can't color or darken glass in any way. If you duplicate glass 500 times, it's not any darker. None of the doors are any darker. None of the windows are any darker. All glass is the same in every single way. And that wasn't really working, but using these metal doors and sort of making them fit was kind of a revelation. It really worked. It was really nice, as you can see. But that was a bit annoying. And also, light doesn't get obfuscated. So if you've got a spot... Actually, three problems then. Light doesn't obfuscate. So if you put a spotlight down and then put something in front of the spotlight, the thing will be lit up, but so will everything behind it. You know, it doesn't block the light in any way. Which I kind of get, because I think that would be very intense on a graphics card or a CPU, whichever it would be intense on. It would be intense on something. And then finally, scaling lights doesn't affect how much light they give off. You know, you can make a teeny tiny light or a gigantic light and they'll give off the same amount of light. And that I would like to see maybe edited or have some control over that, because it is quite limiting. Anywho, so built a little bit the door there, and then this is meant to be a sort of touch panel kind of thing. Like you'd go and you'd use biometrics or you'd swipe a card or something like that. And it would let you through the door. The door is only going to unlock from the outside, this one. The idea is, you know, it's a secure facility in that if they needed to contain the people indoors, they could do that. So I'm building like a little padlock sort of icon here, a little key sort of icon to represent that it's locked at the moment. And later on, there will be an unlocked one. So it'll be like a recurring theme. For this, I very much had in mind the Rock. not Dwayne Johnson, but The Rock is in the film, the Michael Bay film from the 90s. Yeah, 90s, The Rock. Must have been late 90s, mid to late 90s, right? The Rock. And then I realized that it needs to glow. So I started to build it out of letters using H's and duplicating them several times to make a solid block, basically. And then using other letters, I think I used the C eventually, yeah, to make the handle at the top. Made that red, and there you go. You see it's glowing beautifully. We've got this little padlock icon, which I think worked really well, actually. Very intense, which is what I wanted. Very vehemently red. But anyways, in the Rock, there's like these... I can't really remember. There's these green balls, and if you touch them or they get released at all, you kind of start to bubble up and die. It's horrible. And at one point, very early in the film, I think in the prologue, they lock someone in from the outside because they're, you know, getting infected. They're banging on the door trying to get out. It's like, well, I can't let you out. You know, we'll all die. Kind of the same idea, basically. So these doors don't unlock from the inside, they only get locked from the outside. And someone has left some people to die, shall we say, on the inside of this doorway. And you'll see here, that the teeny tiny little light, and it's still just... yeah, can't really do much about it. What I ended up doing, I was quite proud of this though. So what I wanted was like a little... I've got a little light under there, which is fine, under the roof there, but I couldn't have another light because it lit everything up no matter what the size. So I used the eye, which glows at night, you know, the letter I, all the signs glow, and I moved that along it to look like there's a light there, but it doesn't actually provide a light source. I'm not saying I'm a genius, but I might be a genius. I was quite proud of that one. I think it's very, very effective. And there's a top tip. Use, if you want to add lights, but not light, use signs, use letters and stuff like that. And you can duplicate them and make them into solid shapes if you need to. And it works pretty well. Spent a very long time with the kerning key. People were very... people had to make sure the letters were in precisely the right place. And then it was time for a dialo. So we took a little poll at this point. I wanted the clouded one in, that one, because that's my favourite Dilophosaurus skin. However, the people voted, and Dune ended up winning, partially in celebration of the film, but mainly because it's got spikes on it, and that feels more appropriate for a horror game, basically. Realised that the room was a bit too big. I wanted to make sure you could see the Dilo, and so I just brought the walls in a little bit, and there she is. She's called Zelda, by the way. I didn't name her, that's just what the game named her. She's called Zelda, which is a cool name. We're not going to rename her. All the Dilophosauruses have names based on stream viewers. And again, if you want to be named for one of our future dinosaurs, you know, come by in the stream and next time we add multiple dinosaurs. We'll definitely name them after people in the comment section. But Zelda is going to stay Zelda. The light source of this really, really weird thing where as you're walking towards a light, it lights up. But if you walk past the light ceases to exist. Like, the light source has to be in your vision or you don't see the light effect. You know what I mean? It's a weird one, that one. These are all very... I don't want to, like, pretend these are, like, major points or anything like this. This isn't a big deal. Just little things I picked up on whilst I was playing. And things that are really only going to bother me, you know, or, like, in a horror build. You know, they're not big deals at all. And I love that if I did things like this, for example, this spider web crack, the idea being that the dialogue has been contained to some extent, maybe not necessarily just in this room, as you'll see later on. I got hiccups. Contained, but not necessarily just in this room, but has been contained. But she's trying to get out, so she, boof, she bashes her head against the door, and it cracks, but she can't quite get out. Maybe it's... I don't know, whatever. She can't quite get out. So there's some splintering, the glass shatters a little bit, there's some glass pieces on the ground, all these lovely cool effects, but she is contained. For now. Bum, bum, bum. That wasn't very dramatic. Bum, bum, bum. I can't, I'm not that guy. I can't, like, just let go and be that guy. So what I wanted was this room to be a sort of a testing facility kind of thing, you know, scanning people to see. This is, by the way, this is a moment of genius you're about to see. So in my mind, these would be like plastic partitions, you know, like a COVID thing or whatever. And I did that very quickly, so I don't know if you saw it. There's no plastic in the game. There's nothing plastic in the game. Like it's a wall or a texture like that. So what I did was flatten buckets and stretch the buckets to stupid highs, as you can see. You can see from above, I've decided to keep them just on the left, but you can see from above they've got bucket tops. It's just a flattened bucket stretched to a stupid size, and it makes these nice white textured wall partition kind of things. And the idea is that these would be separate little areas where people would be getting tested for this fungus. Then the other genius idea, in my opinion, was to take these curved sunshades, squish these down, put them together like this, and lo and behold, curtains. Eh? Not bad, I think. There's three things we did today, which I think were revolutionary when it comes to maybe people do this all the time, but I thought this was quite clever. So buckets and sunshades, and we made these sort of partitioned little researchy observation testing area kind of things. Now, the third of those three things that I mentioned was what I really wanted, like the idea of, was blood kind of seeping out from underneath one of the curtains. I tried to use a silhouette of a guy, it wasn't really effective. And I was trying all these different things, just anything I could find to see if I could make something that looked akin to blood. And then I thought, well, what about what about the moss? And the moss makes this kind of blood-soaked, blood-dropped kind of pattern. And then someone in the chat actually suggested this, but using rocks. And then I thought, okay, well, we'll use the stalactites in particular because they are spotty, you know, they're in bits like that. And lo and behold, blood pattern. I kind of ruined it. It looked best then, and then I messed it up. But I was pretty chuffed with that set of ideas. The curtains, the partitions, and the blood, I think, was a really inspired little bit of building, if I say so myself. Now, the problem is every time I clicked on the blood, it clicked on the floor, so I had to make the blood tree. And basically, what you do for this is you make sure that if you've got something... I do this in Planet Zoo all the time. Let's say you're building a waterfall and you want to hide the little machinery bits in the rock, so you can't pick it up anymore, right? You can't get to it without moving the rock or deleting the rock, which is annoying. You make sure that all the little bits are in a group, and then you get something much bigger, put it off to the side, and make sure that's in the same group as well. So in this case, all the blood is attached to the blood tree. So I want to get access to the blood, which I can't click on without deleting the floor. I click on the tree first to get me access to the group. No, this was four things, because I was proud of this as well. So I'm not going to say this makes complete sense in how it ends up looking, but I really wanted to have body bags lying on the ground as well. So I thought, okay, once again, we'll use the sunshade fabric, and I kind of started to mold it to the shape of a person. I've got like a little workshop item, which is already, I think that looks pretty good. I've got a little workshop item, which is scaled directly onto a Prehistoric Kingdom guest, so I can model things directly off that size. Now, I know it's a little bit tight to the body, but I wanted to sell the aesthetic. And also, pretending that they've been, what's the word? I said it like 20 times in stream. vacuum packed, basically. You know, there's an infection. There's a fungal infection. It makes sense that it would travel airily. I was going to say orally then. Makes sense that it would travel airily to an extent. So if you're going to have a body, maybe you want to pull all the air out of the bags. I don't know. It just looks better, all right? I tried to give him feet, but the feet didn't really work, it must be said. It's a sneeze pause there. Both of this is real life. But anyways, yeah. And then sort of rescaling the whole thing to make sure it relatively fits with my podcast. And so from above, I think that looks really good. I was really proud of that. From above, I think it's very, very effective. The problem is, from the side, you can see that these are open-ended, right? Which doesn't really make sense. So it only works from above. It doesn't really work from the side. So they're not going to be as big a feature as I maybe wanted. But I've just had a thought about this. I kind of like the idea of you walking into like a warehouse at some point from a higher position. And you can look down and just see hundreds of bodies strewn around the ground, right? There's a scene like that again in Contagion, which has also very much inspired me in this build. A really, really good infection film by Steven Soderbergh, I believe. Highly recommend. So that's kind of part of the idea as well. And then a few of the beds from outside. So the main problem with this build at this point was really just... Latree. Was really just trying to... Also, the dialogues maybe had a little snack in one of them. Was just trying to make the room look like a science room, I think is what I kept calling it. Here we've got our beloved, what do they call it, a scumpo. These are our beloved scumpo air conditioners. And I had I think, quite clever idea with these. I wanted them to not feel like an air conditioner, so make these little glass tubes, and they sit on top. And I think if you kind of just look at it that way, you can kind of see it more like a Jurassic Park 3 style when they go into the testing facility and the raptor's looking at Amanda through one of the tubes. That's kind of the general idea in here. Now, the next idea was to have samples floating inside it. So this is the moss, and it's floating inside of the tubes. And what I really wanted was to have these look like they're full of liquid. Again, if I could change the colour of the glass, I definitely would have done that here. I would have made it like much darker and much harder to see through. But at night time, I think you can kind of sell it. And then kind of lit them up with a little bit of green. That will get toned down quite a lot throughout the video as I kind of messed around with it. But light them up a little bit, and they're kind of like floating samples. We've also got this. There's going to be a lot of fire. But I'm not allowed to use the fire, but there's this flashing water. And I thought, okay, that will make it look like there's liquid moving through the tubes. The problem is you can't see the water effect, the one I'm messing with here. You can't see it through glass. So the water effect would have to sit on the outside of the glass. And even then, you wouldn't see it unless you're inside the room, because you're not going to see it through the glass door. So it doesn't really work, unfortunately. Again, these are things I'd love to have in the game, but I'm not going to pretend they make sense for like most people playing the game at the end of the day, you know? So I can see why they're not. And already the game has so many things that I love that I think most park builders wouldn't have bothered adding. So I can really appreciate that. You know, like destroyed glass and that kind of stuff. I think it's really cool to have. So I can't like pretend otherwise, and that they should add these things. It's just things I want, you know. I do think the ability to change glass color would be really good, and I'm a little surprised that isn't in the game. So I'd love to see that added at some point. The ability to change the color of the glass, make it darker, make it lighter, change the color. I'll stop saying that. That'll change the hue, change the saturation, all that kind of jazz. I think that'd be really good for a lot of builds, and not just weird horror game builds. I think that'd be really good for, you know, general parks. So I'd like to see that added down the line potentially, and I think that wouldn't be that difficult. I don't know enough to suggest that, but I don't think it would be... It doesn't sound that difficult on the face of it, anyway. I'm trying to get the lighting right at this point. The room wasn't working for me. It was too uncluttered. It was too big. I was a little annoyed by how bright the room was as well. Like, I just couldn't darken it any more than this. You know, this is how bright Prehistoric Kingdom is, unfortunately. If I could turn the brightness down and make it super dark and still effective, I would do that. You know, if Cryodenics mod, his new mod, Skylight, worked on this, I would absolutely use it to darken the nights a little bit. But you just can't get any darker than this. And then I had a thought. So I'm in a new save file, because I wanted to keep it. And I thought, if I just bring this wall much closer in, as you can see, everything from the right-hand side gets brought in towards the door, and I had to remodel the other side to make the door fit again, which just made the room a lot smaller. And that tightens the space a lot. And makes the room feel a lot busier, and like it was actually used for something, less blank space. I hate blank space. I'm not good with blank space. So brought the whole room in, and I thought it looked a lot better. I was much happier with how it looked at this point. It looks like a little science labby room where some people have died, some people have been rescued. Whatever, right? And that was very much the idea. And then brainwave that, I think, because she's there and she's wandering around. It's not effective. I need her to go in and out. And there's nowhere for her to go. So we're going to build a little room out here at the side. You're never going to see this. But build a little room out here at the side. Put some bedding in and put some meat. We're going to move that in a second. But she can now wander through the curtain and leave. And I thought, okay, but I need her to come in and out, basically. I need you to see her and not see her. It needs to look like she's going elsewhere in the park, but also that she's here. So I put the meat and some blood behind this table, and look at that guy, look at that. Makes me so happy. Basically, you'll stand here and you're looking into this room, and every now and again she'll walk in and feast on, you can't see it, so the implication is there's a dead body behind the table, and she'll come in and eat from that dead body, and then she'll leave again to somewhere else in the park to threaten you later on. All right, that was a revolutionary moment for me as well. I was very happy with that. And there she is. She keeps climbing on the ceiling and getting stuck. So it's not going to work as a permanent habitat, but it works as a vibe. And then I just wanted to block the door off a little bit, just threw some boxes in. The boxes were really annoying. threw some boxes in there. Just little things to try and block off access to the door a little bit. Oh, and then I solved an idea. I had a new idea as well, which I'm going to have any second now. Yeah, so just a little idea that, you know, obviously the idea is that the infection hit, maybe even before the Dilophosaurus got involved at all, there's an infection, the fungus is spreading, and people are getting locked in the room, right? But I think the idea was we sort of stacked these crates on the other side, so someone's climbed up and knocked through the glass pane, and it's fallen down on the other side, and there she is on the ceiling, and they've climbed through the gap up there in the glass pane to escape, basically. And I think that is nearly about it. I'm not sure what I'm doing anymore. How long have we got left? Yeah, there's about 10 seconds left. Yeah, as I say, it doesn't really work in daytime. Yeah, so we're basically done. So the last thing I need to do is I would like to do some changes to the outside of the building, tear it down a little bit, you know, add some foliage, add some cracks and stuff like that. But I'm going to worry about that for next week. It should be a shorter build in theory. 3 more weeks. But yeah, we'll go check it out in game. And let me know what you think in the comment section down below after you see it. I'll see you in a sec. Okay, as I say, we're going to do this at night time. So this is what we built last time around, of course. This is our courtyard sort of area with the quarantine tents and the military vehicles and the big doors and the big gates. There's our coelophysis. Having a lovely coelophysis sort of time. Hello. Okay, so now we've built this area here. So you go through this sort of mossy opening, and you go through down here. We've had to put some stone in just to keep the coelophysis contained. But, you know, the idea is, as I say, this is a horror game. So you, if you imagine all this as you're a play character in a horror game, you would, of course, climb over the rock to get inside. So you've stumbled your way inside here, and you've entered this new area. You just see the building in the distance. You start walking down this area here. You can see there's the stumps are here. The idea is that the military, the quarantine people, whoever, when they came in, they cut down trees to form a path towards the... That's much brighter than I realised. I might have to kill those lights over there. But they cut down a path to the door, basically, is the idea. Anyway, so we're walking along. There's a little abandoned flashlight here just because I thought it needed some light in the area. And I love my little flashlight, I'm not going to lie. And then you see the building. And I like the idea of most of the building being dark. And then you've got this... The idea is this is meant to lead you in, right? This is the gaping maw of the building enticing you forwards. Like I say, the building does need a little bit of love. And some people had suggestions of having like a radar dish and stuff on top and maybe some red lights. I think that's probably a good idea. We'll probably do a little bit more with the building in the next set of streams. Of course, to the left, as I say, there's the tunnel. I did block it off, as I said. I probably need a better way to block it off, but it's blocked off for now like that. I think it looks really good at night. It just looks like a tunnel. You know, it looks overgrown. It looks like it goes through into the mountain, into the trees. And it's blocked off here because if you go any further than this, you can kind of see that the building is fake. But as long as you stay here, you can't see a thing. You know, it's perfect. And of course, down here, although not lit up at nighttime at all, is the abandoned vehicles, which have been overgrown and taken down with the moss over time. Except I'm assuming that's the letter A, because the letter A in this game refuses to stay dark. I don't know why, but it just lights up constantly. Anyways, so you can kind of see what I mean by the Resident Evil building, right? This kind of... I need to change this roof, though. I don't like that. This ominous sort of mansion-y sort of building, and you're going to enter. And I love how this looks. That is... Like, I know there's nothing to it design-wise. There's no, like, accoutrements. There's no extras. But in terms of just how it looks visually, this is exactly what I wanted. This sterile, clean, ominous sort of corridor. So you're going to walk your way down here. You turn the corner. Same deal again. And the idea is that this wasn't part of the building by default. This was erected by the government, etc., to sort of get people out through a sort of sterile environment, I guess. Then you turn the corner and then bom, 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 you see the red light in the distance. That will calm down in just a second, but you walk forward. So the right way is left. Now, obviously, that's nothing right now. That's part of the future build. But the right way is going to be down there. But the hope is that you as a character would see this and be intrigued. So you can see on the right-hand side, of course, that it's locked. You can't get through. You see that the glass has been knocked out there. There's a smashed glass there. And we can kind of stand around here. You can see we've got our floating samples in the glass over there. It actually looks better up close because it gets a bit darker. And it visibly is actually in the glass. But as you move further away or go through this glass, you see what I mean? Because glass doesn't stack. So if I look through glass at glass, it's like the glass doesn't exist. You know what I mean? There's the body bags down there. Like I say, not as effective at this angle, but much better at this sort of angle. There's the blood seeping out from under there. So this was the one that was completely shut off, but obviously I've opened it up because... Wait, no, it's this one. She does keep getting stuck, is the only problem. She will never move from that position. I have to actively move her. She doesn't need food to survive, but she will still eat it, which is really nice. I'd actually love if Evolution 2 could integrate that, because if you turn off eating or a need for food, they just never eat. But it's nice to have as like an ambient behaviour, right? But anyways, there's the destroyed lab kind of thing. I'm not great at indoor environments and it's hard work. I'd like to maybe have some things that we could stack on beakers and stuff, but again, it doesn't really make sense. And actually, there's the body, the meat behind there, but it's meant to be a body. I'm going to move her and we'll hopefully make this work. Hey, Zelda. There's the door from the other side. I really like it. as a horror game in Prehistoric Kingdom, I think it's really... I think, obviously graphically, it's not quite there, because look at the body bags and stuff like that, but I just think it's really got the vibe I wanted. I wasn't sure it was going to happen for a long time, but I think it really sells that feeling I wanted. I'm really, really happy with it, actually. Anyways, by the looks of it, she's about to arrive. So the idea... And when we do the final tour, I'll make this all happen nice and smoothly, is that you'd approach the door and you're kind of looking in, curious what's going to happen. You see the cracks, and then there she is. She walks in, you're kind of just watching her through the glass. She feasts. And you're like, thank God it's locked. There is actually another one of these panels on... There's a red light over there you can just about see. The idea is that it's locked on both sides. You're not really going to see that, but it's just a little hint. You know, there's a red light over there. Same as this red light. Just telling you that that's what's going on over there. And we can take a little look over here as well. See you in action. See you from the other side. I've never actually done this. Yeah, it looks pretty good from this side as well. And that's the best bit. And then she leaves. She comes in to feast, and you can see the blood spilling out there. She's eaten, feasting on the corpse here, but then she's gone. And she is gone, gone. You know, she's not in the room at all. She's off over there, because she keeps going back to the bedding, so it kind of lures her from here to here. It's kind of video game logic. I was quite proud of that as well. So it kind of lures her from point A to point B, and back and back and back and back and forth. Okay, it's like a broken record for a second there. So... She, for all we know, we don't know what's beyond that. You know, from this perspective, as a video game player, as a human exploring this abandoned park, you know, filming your YouTube videos in this abandoned park, you see her, and then she's gone. And you can't move any further, and all you know is she's out there somewhere in the facility, and you, of course, have to then carry on going. And you will encounter her again at some point, either next or the time after next. I think I might... leave it a little bit, like do one or two more exhibits first and then have her show up again, because I think that builds, in fact, maybe do like a couple of herbivore exhibits, or at least one herbivore exhibit, to kind of put you in a safer frame of mind, and then bam, give you the Dilophosaurus to contend with, you know? I think that's quite a lot of fun. There's the buckets, as I mentioned. As you can see, this thing is very, very ragtag from above, but yeah, is what it is. It's kind of like designing a level in a Skyrim creation kit. And there's the blood tree, looking fantastic. I think you'll all agree. Blood tree. So I click the tree, and it also clicks the blood, and we'll use that throughout the game. Because I'll show you, if I tried to click this blood like this, it doesn't work. You see, I'm picking up the surrounding building instead. So, blood tree. I'll show you this very quickly at daytime, but like I say, it doesn't really work, and it's not really designed. You know, it loses everything. It just doesn't have the same effect whatsoever. It's cool that the red light still works, and it's okay, but it's definitely not. It's not the same at all. So this is very much meant to be viewed at night, but the outside is okay in daytime, I think. Just pop through these walls quickly. Yeah, so there's the tunnel. Again, you can see that it ends. There's like this line here a little bit better in daytime, but it does give you a better view of the foliage work I've done in the area. And same over here with the trucks. You can kind of see those better in the daytime. But that is the end of part two of our build. So, oh, beautiful. The shadows are a bit wrong because I know. I think I need to turn the quality down. So by next time, what we're going to be working on is we're going to be destroying the building a little bit. I'm just going to make it overgrown, maybe add a few new decorations, stuff like that, block it off a little bit more. The tunnel is going to extend. I think it's then going to be a herbivore exhibit of some form. I haven't really thought through. I like the idea of like a feeding area kind of thing, but I need to figure out how it's going to tie in with the story. It'll probably be the end of the quarantine section. You know, you're eventually going to be out of the quarantine bit, and you're just going to enter the actual facility itself, which can have outdoor sections and stuff like that as well. That's fine. And then probably wrap back around to another Dilophosaurus habitat, or maybe two herbivore habitats, and then I don't know, whatever, we'll figure it out down the line. But either way, that is the horror themed Dilophosaurus habitat. Hope you enjoyed. If you like this build, please throw me a like down below. If you enjoyed the video, yada yada yada. Hope you all have a absolutely lovely weekend from me and from Zelda. How you doing, Zeld? See, Zelda, Dilophosaurus, having a lovely time. And yeah, thank you so much for joining me. Cheers, much love, as always. And hopefully see you next Friday as well for the live stream. Bye-bye. Oh.